Why even use a shell scripting, right? That's where it will be coming. Okay, now let me start with that part. Okay. So what is shell scripting? So if you see this in diagram, suppose you are using a OS. Okay, it could be Linux, Ubuntu. I mean, Ubuntu is kind of Linux, in Mac OS, anything. There, suppose you are interacting with the applications, but you are not directly interacting with the kernel or the hardware. The hardware where the device is connected is kernel. And with kernel is the shell scripting. And shell scripting is the application. Shell scripting, you can say, combined with the application getting used. So as a user, you can use shell scripting to send instructions to kernel, and kernel will do as you say in the shell script. As you mentioned, the command will get executed. That's all it does. So in simple sense, you are a user, you are giving input, giving input to shell scripting or the commands, and that is getting interpreted in the kernel. So that's how it works in simple words. Nothing is complex here. So let's go by the definition. A shell script is a list of commands in a computer program that is run by Unix shell, which is command line interpreter, as I told. A shell script usually has commands that describe the step, the different operation performed by shell script or program execution. Of course, the commands you run. File manipulation, text printing, these are like common use cases. A wrapper is also kind of shell script that creates the program environment, run as a program. So we can create a put the lines, each command do something, and we make a script, and that's how the program is all it does. Now let's go to the next part. So there are a lot of type of shells. First type is bourne shell. We got it as well as bourne bash or bourne again shell. So this shell is like, is very common. I mean, it's most OS will find it in bin bash, you can say. Another one is C shell. So which is like this shell script program is a C programming shell syntax, and it almost similar to C. Another one is conch shell. Now conch shell is a Unix-based shell scripting program initially based on the bash. So you can say it's a bit advanced version of bash shell. And TCH, there is no definition or full form is there, but it's like it's the most advanced version of the C shell. That's all it is you have. Okay. Now, why should even you use the shell scripting? There's a lot of, actually, what I say in a post that your imagination is the limit. But let's come into like the common use cases. It's usable. I mean, shell script don't have to be boring. You can manipulate things. You can make it more interesting. We'll be, while I show the demos and all, we'll be finding it that up very soon. Reuse. So suppose you done a really maintenance job, like doing renaming a file, maybe, or could be like editing a file, could be running commands or backup kind of things. So those kind of things, you can make them automatic using the shell scripting. I'll be showing anyway, that's just to say you can make iterate things using, if you write a shell script, you can execute that to do things like making a DB backup, could be renaming a file, could be removing a file. Suppose you have a file that is stored, which is not more needed. Using shell scripting, you can write a script which will remove the file when you run it. Always available, shell script you can use instantly. Readability. So shell script, if you write properly with proper variables names, with proper kind of commands, if possible, then it's more readable and it's more even easy to understand sometimes. Shell scripting is possible. I mean, we all know the power of shell scripting. Otherwise, in DevOps job, you can see in the system maintenance and all that. Shell scripting is heavily used. Okay, so what is bash scripting? I will not go to definition much. Think about like simple shell scripting. What do you normally in the command line, you normally execute the commands. So in shell scripting, you have a list of the commands you'll be running, and that's all it is. For now, think like that. We can come to this big definition later on. So yeah, before jumping into the shell scripting, what you need to know first? You need to know the basic Linux command. I'll be showing you not everything, but like small commands so that you can get used to these commands, and we'll get started now. So let's see. Okay. Okay, I'll be answering all the queries little, I mean, after this, like, let's get done with the demo a bit first. Then I will see the question, I'll be answering them also. So stay with me. Okay, let's stop the screen and let's share the screen with the command line. So yeah, of course, we are working on a command line, I mean, shell scripting, which is mostly in command line. So let's use the command line. This is the developers most familiar with. Even as a system engineers or, you know, DevOps architect, we spend our most of the time in the, say, the command line only. Okay, so what are the common commands? Let me share. So first command we'll be learning is, let's first actually have a copy of the commands we are going to use first. Okay. Let's do that. Okay. We will command with the very basic command. I mean, we start with the very basic command. First command is pwd. What is pwd? As the name suggests, it's a smaller version, present working directory. Okay, we'll learn these smaller commands and we'll join them together and make a shell script. But you have to learn, if you don't know what the command do, then how can you run a shell script, right? So let's do that. So if you run pwd, it will give us the current working directory. Okay, then the commands come cd. That is changing directory. So if you run, I think maybe I should make it bigger so you can, you will be able to see it properly. Okay, looks good. So if we run, suppose we have a lot of files, let's say, let's create a, let's go back first. So if we do cd dot space dot dot, we'll go back to the parent directory. Let's clear this. Now, let's say, I want to like go to whatever directory I have. Suppose I create a directory. I'll be showing the advanced create directory commands in a while. But let's say I'm creating a directory. Say sample folder or directory. So, okay, we create a sample directory. Now you want to move inside the directory or folder, you can say. So we have to use cd, then the folder name. Okay. So if we run pwd, that is present working directory, we will see we are inside the new directory that we have created. Okay. Then comes, suppose you're working in multiple here and there, I mean, this command line, this command line, inside that folder, you want to go back to a very like back or maybe home directory. What you can run, cd, this command, this time, and you'll be in the working directory. If you do pwd, you'll see you're in the current working. Like right now, I'm in the, whoever the logged in user's current directory. So I'm logged in as Sandeep Das, and for that current directory is user Sandeep Das. That is. So that's how it is. Then, I mean, we understand now what cd does. Cd means changing directory. For to go to a particular directory, we have to give the directory name, like sample directory I just created. Sample underscore dir. Okay, go. If you want to go back from this directory, we have to use cd dot dot, okay? Cd space dot dot, we'll go back to the previous directory. So similar, these are the very basic changing directory commands. Now let's come to the listing command, because I think listing command should be the one of the most basic command you should know. What this command does, it lists the file or folders you have. Let's say ls. So I have this kind of all keys file and all that, everything in my working home directory. Now, It's like not that readable. I mean, you are doing ls, is giving you the list of the files and directory, but it's not that human readable, right? What you can do to run ls minus l, and it gives us more formatted with more detailed files name with the proper file name. Proper, this is the permission level. So suppose you have a file, you are getting a file, you can see the permission level like this. So this is the logged in user, that is you are, or the administrator, you can say these are the group, okay, and these are for other users. This is like your access, you can say, if you are the user, we have created by the owner of the file, then you have the read and write aspect example, say in the group. So if you're a particular user group, what have the access? They have access to the read access, and what others have the access, the read access only. So you can change and manipulate this. I will be coming to that later also. So let's first focus on the ls command. So we did ls, Now, ls minus l command lists the files and the directories in the current directory with a long table format, which is most usable. Now, if you want to see a particular directory, what that particular directory has, we can do that also. Say, let's say I have a directory called, see, anything starting with D is a directory. That's a very good part to understand first. So anything starting with a D is a directory. See, this, there is nothing D, right? It's a file. If you see here D, that's a folder or directory. So let's say Mongo. It's a directory. So MongoDB, I was like using for MongoDB for database part. So ls minus L, and then, ld. LD, then the directory name. You can see that directory is giving that. So using that, you can see the content. I think nothing is inside the MongoDB probably. Only data is there. Okay. And then suppose there is a hidden files, like dot files are there, which you want to like, let's see, clear it, ls minus a. You can see, I think we had inside the mode directory. Let's do that. And ls minus a. So if you do simple ls, you will not see the hidden files, the dot files. You cannot see the dot files. If you want to see with the dot files, you have to do ls minus a. What simple? You can see all the dot files here yourself. See, these are the hidden files. You will not able to see, but now you can see. So this like this, there are a lot of commands also in the document I will give you. It will be there, something to worry. I want to show a more bit of, like I shown the list command. Now let me show, I showed you the basic changing directory, present working directory. Now let me show you the creating the directories, more advanced part, okay? I mean, I showed you previously, but let's see properly. So to create directory, you have got mk make dir make directory, then the directory name. Let's say this is a test directory. Okay, if you do that, the directory will be created. Test directory. If you want to go inside test, let's go directory. If you do pwd, you will see the current working directory. Okay, so similarly, you can see if you want to go back, just go here like that. Now, suppose you want to create a directory inside a directory and that private directory doesn't exist. What to do? You can run mkdirectory minus p. Just say, right now there is no directory called. Suppose you try to create like test2dir and then let's say the main directory. It will not be possible. Okay, but it's possible using a simple flag called p. Done. You can go to test to. This is a very basic command to get started with. Otherwise, you'll be lost if you don't have any idea what you're doing. So this is the very basic commands if you run in a Linux. Now, suppose you want to remove a directory, what to do? So rmdir, then say, now it can only remove the empty directory. Let's say, I think this, that test directory is our empty one. So test dir is removed. If you do, like if you try to cd test dir, it will not, because it's not there anyway. It's not there, it's removed. Similarly, we have created directory, we have removed the directory. Now what about creating file and doing that? So let's see. So let's say I want to create a file. Let's create a directory first. Say basic Linux commands demo. Okay, so sorry, I have to create it first. So mkdir, so run mkdir, then you created this directory. Just go inside this directory and let's say we are in the proper directory now and I want to create a file. So there are multiple ways to create a file. One of the easiest using the touch. So if you give touch, then say file1 or file.txt. If you do ls, then you'll see the file is created. If you do ls minus la, you will see these are the references. Dot is the current folder reference, and this two dot means the parent directory reference, as I was showing in the cd command. Okay, now this is a file. Okay, and these are the default as the owner, the read write access, and the group has the user group have the read access, and the other users have the read access. So we have this file. Now we want to edit file. So you can use vireader, vi file.txt. Using that, you can edit the file, like changes. Or if you have a nano installed, so you can use nano editor. These are useful stuff if you are working in a, suppose you have to change the file configuration, you are not willing to, like, it's very need of the time and you want to make a quick change. If you have VI editor, or if you have this kind of editor, you can very quickly change that and make the change and then execute that. So you can do that way. So change to, just for, you know, any demo purpose. And easy, it have like more advanced command like that. It will be very easy to understand. Okay. Now we want to see the content of that file. We can run cat, like cat just read the file and then show the data in the front like this, change to. Now suppose you want to rename the file. Now renaming concept doesn't work like that. It's in Linux or Unix, you have to move the file. So mv then file.txt to, let's say, file new.txt. And if you do check ls, you'll see file is moved. Now suppose you want to make a copy of that. I mean, we moved it. That means it says removing the older reference and creating a new file, right? Now I want to copy that file. Simple commands to do copies, cp, then the source, that is file name, the source file name, and then the destination file name. It could be any users. You can just copy to previous directory or any kind of directory if you want. Let's say I'm copying the same directory. How to do it? Cp, then the source, and the current, the copied file name. Let's say file copied.txt. You can see file copied txt here. So that's easy how it is to run the Linux command. These are the very basic commands if you want to start self-scripting. Of course, in the documentation, I've already given all the references that you need to get started. Still, I'm giving here also, so you can get started with that. Okay. I think now I want to explain a little bit more about the permission stuff, because mostly people get confused in the permission part. They get very confused. I mean, what is that? Why it's like this? Why the read access, write access? Why you're giving some values like this? They got confused. That's why I'm going to explain a bit in a first in using slide, and then in actual commands I'll show. So let's do that. So okay, yeah, I'll be coming to that only. So Vasuki, I will be showing that permission just a moment. So let me start sharing the slide again. I hope you can see the slide now. Okay, so just before that, I have all the commands here, just for the basic commands, copy, remove, you will get the file anyway for the session. So let's come to the permission. I showed you that read, write, and all this permission. And there's a very basic analogy here. So let's say you want to give user, like you see there, like read, write, and execute level. So R means read, W means write, and X means execution. Okay. And as you can see, read, write, and execute. Here, if you want to give read access, you can use simply chmod plus R, like whatever access they have already. Adding plus R means giving elevated access to the read to the particular file. I'll be showing you, so don't worry, I'll be explaining in a more greater deal. So you can see from the commands here also. And suppose you want to give write access, you can do chmod, then plus R, then W, then the file name. You can do that way. Or you can just simply give chmod. Then you can see here that what is like, what will be for the particular current, the owner, what will be for the group, and what will be for the other users. You can have to say that part. And that way we can give like, what are the number for that? Okay, like I'll be showing you now. I think you can reference the table later also. Let me show in the actual command line how it works. And then after that only, we'll just jump into the actual scripting. Okay, so understand this part very, very thoroughly. Otherwise, you might face, I think in my job, let me share experience, short experience. I will not waste much time. So I was trying to execute a script in a cloud environment, and that script didn't work. And I was like crazy, why it's not working? Well, the basic part that why it didn't work was that I forgot to give the execution permission. So suppose you're writing a shell script and you didn't give it the execution permission, and the shell script didn't execute, it will be pretty messed up. So understand that you need to give the execution permission first, and then you can execute. Okay, keep in mind that part. I'll be showing you more detailed way, so don't worry. So actually, let me start sharing the entire screen to explain, otherwise it will be a problem. Stop share. You can see it. Okay, so let me make it a little bit more smaller. Okay, go back to the what directory we are in. Linux command. I think we are okay with that. Okay, so let's say do you have any file here? Okay, we have a file, two files. Okay, file copied and file new. We can say we can create more file. Touch file. I think I forgot to show you the remove commands. So just simply do rm, then the, and you see, done, the file removed. Okay, and similar way, you can also remove again. Like if you want to remove whatever file, you don't want to give any name, you can do rm minus rf star, and then it'll remove all the files. You see, no files available. You didn't give any name. So this is a very basic, pretty command, basic commands. I'm just showing. Make sure to that, remember this part. Okay, I think we are good to go here. Okay, let's create a file first. Touch file one dot txt. Don't worry about the contents, we don't need that for this demo. File two dot txt, file three dot txt. Now I thought if I will give the touch file 3.txt. Now you can see we have three files. If you want, I mean, I use the ls command to know we have three files. If you want to see the what permission they have, so give l command. Okay, giving that command give you like what are the permission each file have. So this, make sure you remember. I think maybe it's a bit smaller, so make it, let me make it bigger. So understand very, very, very closely. This part is like, it's a, like it's a directory. If it's directory, it will be de-added. If not, it's just blank. This three, read the owner of this file. I mean, the current user also, you can say that read, write, and then dash. It's not executable. It's only readable and writable. For a group of other, I mean, users group, it have the read access. And that's it, only read access. The other two are blank, right? And for other users also, it has only read access. Okay. So if I want to make this file that only I should be able to access and no one should be able to access, what to do? Let's do this. So let's say chmod, that is the command to do that. Okay, chmod, then the permission you want to give. Now I want to explain this part because it's very, very important. So zero means nothing. I mean, you can do like minus R from the file name, say file one txt. We do that. If you do ls minus l, you understand? I only have the write access from other, I mean, we remove from everyone. So we can have read access, chmod. But this way very sometimes very confusing. Okay, I will show you numbering. It will be a lot easy. So plus R. Now, if I want to give the read access to only, what to do? Allow all users to read the permission to group and others. I want to give the owner. Okay, so let's say I want to give. Yeah, so you can see in here, right? CH mode go equal to that equal to plus R. The file add read permissions to the owner and the group. So let's say chmod owner is equals to, I think it's zero, O is equals to plus R, and then the file name. So file one dot txt, what will happen? Let's see, ls minus l, you see, I think it's become other. I think G, I think. Version to the owner and the group. Let's give that. But you can understand that sometimes it becomes very complex using these words. So, okay. Now, see, using that sometimes become difficult. If you think number, it will be a lot easy. So, just do it using the number. So this number represents a particular, like it can be only three digits, okay? For one number for like giving a seven zone, let's say chmod give permission 777 file one a txt. If we do l, you can see given all kind of permissions, right? You don't have to give any fancy names and all that. Now, I want to, like at the beginning I say, I want to give only read access to myself as a owner and other and group. I don't want to give any access. So chmod. So let's see, let's reference the table. I want to give read and write 5. And I don't want any access to others. 00, 500. Okay. The file name. File1.txt. See how easy it is. That easy. So, sorry, I think it should be 600. So, reference to the R plus W, read 6. So, 600, if you do minus L. I have the only, like, owner read and write access, but other don't have any kind of access, right? Think about, I want to give other, maybe myself and group read and write access, and I don't want to give others any access. So, chmod. Myself, I want to give read and write 6. I want to give only read and write other read access to group. So again, 6, and others, I don't want to give any access. 0. Come in mind, make sure 6 means read and write, and 0, nothing. Then the file name. So file 1.txt. Let's check what is the permission. So owner have the read and write access, group have the read and write access, but others have no access at all. I think now it's much clear that how this permission works. I think number one is very, very easy to understand. I mean, if you remember this, the table, or maybe put it somewhere for the reference and use it for when giving the permissions, it will be very useful, because otherwise naming and all become very complex later. Even the numbering is a much easier way. Now let's say the main part. Let's write a sales script, okay? And I'll show why this permission is important. Show that, let's do that. I'll be creating one simple, let's say hello world. I mean, it's the pretty basic one. I mean, when we learn Node JavaScript, everywhere we do print the hello world first, and then you go for the advanced programming. So let's do that here, also same thing. Well, I'm going to use the nano editor. So nano, let's say the file name I want to give hello world dot sh, because it's a shell script, right? So sh. And here's one more thing I want to show. Hash, this means command. So this part will not execute, it is simple command. While you add this symbol, it becomes a special category, you can special character. Then I want to make it's called Shebang line. So it's Shebang line. I want to give that. I want to make sure what kind of shell I want to execute. So it's bin bash. Okay. Let's and then I want to like print hello world. So here printing is echo. I'll after this sample only, I will show the basic commands first, and then I will execute all the commands in front of you guys, so you can later have the confidence to execute yourself and do a lot of stuff. Okay, so have patience and let's see. Echo and then say hello world. Okay, let's do control X, Y, save the file. So let's verify the file is there. So yeah, file is there. You can see, hello, okay. This is a typo, but it's okay. I mean, just like demo only, right? So hello world, let's say, see, I make a mistake. I want to make it proper and I'm doing that right now. So hello, move to hello world. See, this is like how you should be using that. It's much more usable, right? I'm using a command to rectify things and do ls minus l. Yep. Now it's hello world. Now, if you, I want to execute this one, okay? To do that, hello world, hello underscore dot sh. Oh, you don't have permissions, right? Now see why. If you see here, the when it is the default file, there is nowhere execution, right? See, no. No, here the that you don't have the access. I mean, X, right? It's not executable. Simply, it's not executable. You have the read access, write access, but you don't have the execution access. How to add the execution access? There's reference to the numbering part. There is two way. We can, of course, simply make it like let's make a copy of that file also, so I can show using the different method also. So let's make a copy of the file cp hello world. To hello world 2.sh. So I'll show what with say L. First I will show example with the hello world, and then I will show example with the hello world 2.sh. Okay. So first make change in the hello world. So simply chmod plus x and then hello world dot sh. If we do let's tell. So hello world. You see, everywhere you have the execution access now, right? If we try to do the hello world now, it should work fine now. Yep, it printed the hello world. See. Now I showed using plus plus x thing, but how do you use the numbers? So if you reference to numbers to make it executable, we have to. Like make sure that it's readable, writable, and executable. So read, write, and executable. So I want to make only, suppose I want to make it only executable for me, not for others. How to do that? I can with chmod 7, and then for others, okay, do read, write 6, and then the file name. The file name is hello world. I think we are going to use the 2.sh. If we do ls minus l, you'll see. This file also have the execution only for me, not for others. So this is very important. You might sometimes want to create shell script, but only execute for you, not for others. In that cases, this is for you. So let's see and run. I mean, it's working or not. Hello world, 2sh, and you'll see it printed hello world. So our first shell script working perfectly fine. Now let me show you the basic shell scripting that you should know, and then we'll slowly we'll go for the advanced levels, and at the end, like from nothing or from scratch, I will show how from your local, suppose out of any machine, you create a backup file, and that backup file you can move to S3. Example, I will show the end. So the first is okay. Let's simply let me just show you the commands you need to understand first. Stop the sharing. So let's share it. Chrome tab. Just getting reference. I think you can see it now. Okay. So basic skill scripting. I will show first the variables. Basics. I will not go to very advanced level. Not even make it too complicated. Let's go with the basics. Variables. You can give like name. It's a variable definition. I mean, a variable name. You're giving equals value, and then you can just print. These are the ways you can print it. Echo name, it will print the value. Also, you can do echo dollar name, it will print the value. Echo dollar name, and then the like in curly braces, you can, and that will also print the value. These are there are use cases. I mean, you think why there is multiple ways to do the same thing, but there is use case. I'll show that later. Okay, so now string quotes, like inside string quotes, I think the same here, there's more details. Shell execution. Suppose in a you I mean inside when that echoing you are doing echoing normally is I mean you showing the like it's just if you okay let me show I mean showing the demo. If you do echo pwd, it will just simply like show the pwd, not the exit commands. But if you use dollar, then inside that you mention the pwd command, it will give you the properly. And functions, I will also show the functions. Conditions, I will be coming in a more greater detail. Brace expansion also, I will try to cover, but let's say that's not important. If you're a beginner, you don't have to worry that part. And string mode. But let's first focus on the variables, string code, the cell execution or function, because these are the very important ones. Okay, these are the things you are going to use like daily basis every time. But otherwise, other things you will be using, but in not that greater extent. Okay. So let's do that. Let's go to our beautiful command line. Stop it. And let me share the command line again. So let us discuss our command line here. Make it big. I hope you guys can see it. Okay, getting bigger and better. Okay, clear. Now I will show. I mean, we have one hello world. Let's say some test program. Say test example or example. What is it? Example one. So nano example 1.sh. Okay. So in this file, I mean, in this shell script file, I want to take input, okay? Maybe for the first at the beginning, it's okay, just the variable we will supply. So let's say name, doesn't matter how we just give the variable name, and you have to put the same thing so to execute. So name is, let's say Sandeep, my name, Sandeep. And I want to print in the console with my name. So you can do like that, echo. Then my name is multiple ways, but if you're doing inside the quotes and if you do like name, let's see what happens first, and then we'll see the use case. Then my name is name. Okay, so why? So let's do that. Example 1.sh. Permission denied, right? Now, it's a permission denied, right? Oh, okay. Because we didn't make it executable. So let's go chmod plus R and then example 1.sh. So, okay, let's run, try to run it. Example, let's copy paste the file simply. Let's do, I think I'm missing something maybe. Example 1.h mode plus, I think I put the R instead of, I mean, XX. Okay, sorry, my bad. Let's do run again. I think it should run fine. See, my name is name. It didn't print it the actual my name, right? So let's edit the file. Nano. Let's clear the screen. Otherwise, it's too cluttered, right? So nano, then the file name. See what is the file name. It's example1.sh. Nano, then the file name. Okay. Name and then Sandeep. Now, if we want to show the name here, what to do? What if we put like this, dollar, and then try it. It put it. Now, what if we try to do like this? And let's see. Again, it worked. So if you don't use this expression, it will not take the variable in consideration. It will just print as a normal string. But if you put the proper expression, then it will keep, like, it will pull the value and will show properly. That's a very basic one. Now, let me show you a good example here. So now what about taking input from the user? I mean, some interactions, interactive shares, you might see someone using some command line is taking some input from you and then processing the input, giving something, that kind of thing, right? So let's do that. So what if, yes, edit the file, example.sh. Here, instead of name, we can just simply ask, what is the name? Echo. What is your name? Okay, and then read name and let's see how it works. So execute it, Sandeep, say Sandeep 1, and it giving me Sandeep 1. So that way you can take the variables as an input using the read command. Okay. Now I think I've shown you that command. The execution. Support you want to okay. How you can take an input of another command. Let me show you that part. Suppose you want to print the current working directory, or it could be anything. Just suppose here current working directory. So let's say work directory variable you are using. Okay, let's first do the mistake and then let me show you how to do it properly. So working directory, we do pwd, and then if you type to, let's see what happens. Echo current working directory wd, then I think I did a mistake. Echo should be in smaller case. Let me show that. See, it's showing simply current working directory pwd. It's not giving proper value, right? I mean, you want to get actual path, not the simple pwd string, isn't it? To do that, let's edit the file. What if give a dollar sign, and then this way you can make that command. You're evaluating the command and getting the input from the command. So let's do that. I think I did not save it. Let me properly give it. It's changing somehow. Let me see. Yeah, now it should work. No. See, minor mistake happened, so don't worry. Now, if you execute, yeah, see, it's giving current working directory is the this one. That's how we can get one command's output as a input. I mean, we're storing in a variable, and then we're utilizing the variable. You can utilize anyway. I'm just printing it. You might want to use it for some text generation. Like, let me show. In this directory, I want to make a let's say I want to create another folder in a particular this directory. How to do it? And also I will take the folder input name from the user itself. Let's do that. So this is the working directory. Let's say echo, please enter the new directory name, let's say, and you'll ask the user to give it read new directory name, and if reading it, then you are saying that mkdir, we are making a directory. Now see how I'm going to utilize the this value and then create the directory. So the directory should be like this. We have to, these are the concatenation. I will show the proper comments just after this, but this is how we can concat it. Dollar, and then the working directory, then slash, then the new directory, I mean name that you just getting from this one. Okay. And we can say new directory. We can even store this value in a first in a other variable. How can do that? Say new, just a moment, new dir path. We have defined a variable here, new directory path, that equals this value. And we will reuse the value here. Okay. And then I'm just going to give the dollar. If this reference to, if you don't give anything, it's just simple directory name. But what if we give the dollar and this, and we say new directory created at, say, dollar. Again, we are just showing the string value here. New path. So what are you doing? You are getting the present working directory path completely in a storing in a, this variable. Then we are asking user to enter the name of new directory. We are getting the new directory name in this variable, and then we are storing that entire new path in a new directory. I mean, is a new variable, and then you are creating a new directory using mkdir, then the new directory path. And let's see what happens if you do that. So enter, let's say Sandeep new dir. And see this new directory created. So let's say ls minus l, and we have Sandeep new directory created. We can just cd into this new, and that works. If you do pwd, you can see the current directory path here. So that's, see, this is how you're going to utilize cell scripting. Think more innovative way that you run normal commands daily. How can you make a script and make that, like, instead of running 10 commands, you just execute the script and that done. That kind of mindset you have if you want to learn a cell script, or maybe you want to do a DevOps engineer, because DevOps engineer, we write like my most of time as a pass, like writing the deployment script or writing the build scripts for as a DevOps engineer. And then other tasks also we have, but like maintenance job and all. But still, these are the very, you know, more prime time that is getting utilized while working in a DevOps project. So this is very important here. Okay, I have shown you the basics. Now it's time to know some very little bit more advanced, which will be more similar to you guys, but just wanted to show you. Okay, so let me show that part. So let me just stop sharing this and start sharing the presentation again. I hope you guys can see the presentation. So don't worry, guys. I will just, after a short while, I will check all the commands. Let me try to cover this fast, because this is a lot of stuff, right? Okay. Now here, basics. Like, we cover the basics of this variable and all. There are multiple ways you can, you know, manipulate the string, like slicing, like substitution, slicing, like getting a particular value from the string and all that. You can just simply try it out and see how it works. I mean, I've shown you how it works. You just have to tweak a bit. And this substring and all that. See, if you want to see the length of the particular variable, you can like dollar, then like you can do that way. I will cover that this length part, but you can do all this kind of stuff, manipulation of this file and all, in manipulation of the string. So you can do all this stuff. I'll be jumping into little bit more complex stuff, but let me show the length part. I mean, that's very easy and it's very usable command. Sometimes you want to see how much big the length of the file name is. It's a very, you know, sometimes when we pass the parameter, before passing the parameter, we want to make sure this is satisfying the length. So if you want to see the length of the particular variable value, you should be using that. So let me show you that part. It's important, that's what I'm showing, because it will be required for later when you work on the actual applications. And that is, okay. Let me clear all the stuff. It's a lot of stuff in the screen now. And let's create a new example, and we can call it, say, nano example 2.sh. Okay, whenever you're creating a script file, make sure to put .sh extension, okay? It is better for your own reference also. And you want to first define a variable, say sample variable is equals to, this is just a simple text. Anything, just one example, right? Now we want to do what? We want to print the what length this string have. Okay, it could be some kind of variables or key parameters to pass. Before passing, you want to see that you have a limit on the passing characters. So that kind of check, I will show how to do this kind of checks later. We're going to bit deeper on that. But understand how you can check the length of that. Echo, and then the commands is dollar. So echo dollar, then hash, then simple. I think I did a typo. Simple variable. Simple variable. Except, yes, let's see example 2, we did properly or not. And yeah, this is it. Let's try to execute again. If I try to execute, it will be error. Remember that I used to work with a lot of sales scripting, still I get this kind of errors sometimes, okay, because I forget to do the permission part. So always make sure that before running a sales script, you give them make it executable. Okay. Now if we try to execute it, it's the particular line, it's 26 characters. That's how we understand. Okay, let me go back to, now we are coming into the main things, okay? We covered the basics, we covered the variables basics. Now come to the loop, because I think loop is very important. So let me first show you the documentation regarding loop, and then I will show some example using the loop. Okay, so the screen, and then share, say screen, then tab. Okay, I hope you guys can see it. Okay, right now you can see it. So in this this is like basic loop for I like normal programming logic, similar kind of thing. I in particular, you know, could be string, could be array, could be any that kind of stuff. Then do what the exact function you want to run, execute here, and then done. Like for I iteration in the main subject, then run the particular command, or if you want to process anything like that, you can run C-like groups like this: for I is equal to 0, I less than 100, I plus plus do echo I. You can do that. You can do ranges. You can loop between the ranges, like for I in from 1 to 5, do each, welcome I, like that. You can read lines. Suppose you have a file and you want to read line, you can like cat file.txt, then while, read the line, do, then print each line, line by line, like that way. And forever while do, like it will keep running. And I think if you run this command, it will ultimately like make everything hang and you have to restart the machine. So don't use that if you unless you need it. You have to have a break statement there also. And ranges, I think ranges, this is an example, I think, of the ranges. With size, say I in 5 to 50 to 5 is a reverse range kind of thing. You can do that also. So here, let me show example of the basic loop first. And then we'll maybe show the range range better. I think that will be very easy to understand for you guys. So for I, let me just go to the command line and show you. Stop sharing. Share the screen. Share window. Okay. I think you guys can see the screen now. Just clear it. And we have, we'll call it example three. So nano. Again, I'm using nano command, but you can all, anytime you can use like Vim or any kind of editor you have. Local editor, you can also use that also. So nano, then example 4.sh. Here we want to run that that range command, right? So let me just pull that. So for I in let's say 1 to say 20, just for example, then this, then do. Now every programming language have their own syntax. You just have to follow in shell scripting their syntax. That's it. Don't try to think overcomplicated where this have that, this doesn't have that. Doesn't matter. You are using shell scripting. So think about shell scripting way how to do it. Like I started as a PHP engineer, then I migrated to Node.js, and then like I know how it feel like something from something. But fundamentally level it's the same. So don't worry about all this kind of stuff. And we are doing echo. Again, echo what echo does is just simply print it like console log, like printf, that kind of thing. Say current current index is, let's say dollar, then I, then after you're done. So if you run that, let's see what happens. So we have example 4. I don't know why I did it for CV3, but anyway, let's move it to 3 actually. 2 SH2 3 SH. See, I'm using this move command, ls command, all the stuff, right? So you should be also very used to this kind of things to make your life a lot easier. To that, let's confirm lsl. Okay. So we have this again. See, this file doesn't have the execution access. So chmod. For execution part only, I think plus x is better. But again, if you I'm doing when I'm doing x, it giving everyone executable access. If you want to do for a particular like owner or a particular group, make sure to use the numbering. That's much easier. So give the file name and then let's execute it. The file name. Yep, it works as expected. It's just loop between the from a leg range. So yeah, similar way you can run other functions. I mean other loops also. There is no point doing that, but I want to cover the reading of lines of a file because that's a pretty sometimes pretty good example. Okay, so let's do that. To do that, let's first clear it. Okay. Now we want to give it. It's a we are calling it example 4. Okay, we have 3.1, right? Example 3. Now it's 4 example. So sudo, not sudo, just nano example 4.sh. And let's say cat. We didn't get any file, but we'll create it. Don't worry. Maybe we have that example 1.sh. Why not read that itself? Do we have it? No, this not take a time waste. So this is file one. I'll just create a file after this. Done. TXT. Or maybe whatever say. We want to ask input from a user and what file name user give, it will read that file. It's much more innovative that way, right? So read like echo. See, you have a lot of use cases. I'm just showing you one after one. Think that way. Either enter the file you want to read. Okay. Then read file name. Okay. Then cat dollar file name. You know how to mention variable. I think I discussed two slide back. This is how you want to access it because it's a variable. If you like previously I was giving direct name, right? File one or something like that, but I'm giving a file name. So any file name that I give, it will concatenate that file like that way. And then we are using this symbol. This symbol just carry forward the output to next what you want to do. So we are carry forwarding the print on the text that is getting shown in the screen to the next forward. We are doing do and then read line, then do echo dollar line, and then done. Okay, so let's do that and see what happens. We have the file, ls, I think, example 4. Again, it's good to make a practice to use the less minus l. That will make sure you have execution or not. Sometimes otherwise just normal printing, normal listing of file, you don't understand really that a file executable or not for execution. So let's make it chmod plus x, then the file name. The more you keep using it, the more you get used to it. Okay. At the beginning also, I was also afraid of using SalesScript. Oh my God, what is SalesScript? Could I ever use it? But see, after keep using it and using it, it become like, oh, SalesScript, I will be doing maybe in an hour or so, I will complete the entire functionality. That kind of confidence will have. But it doesn't take an entire hour. Sometimes it done within 30, 40 minutes, maybe 20 minutes. Based on the complexity, it takes time, to be honest. Sometimes even takes days. So again, it's a problem. It's not a problem, it's on the project, it depends. Okay, so we have the file executable now, I think. Let's verify. Yes, executable now. And if we do, now I don't have a file at the moment. So let's get a file. So nano, then let's say file sample, txt. In file sampling, say hello one, hello two, hello three, and like that. Let's not make too many. Now, if we try to execute the sales script, let's see what happens. So again, you can run like this, or you can run like this. It's up to you. Enter the file name, and file name is this. Okay, let's see. So cat file name token do. Let's see what happened here. So let's edit it. Oh, no, not that one. So let's go nano example 4. Let's see what wrong we did. Nano 4 sh. So cat file name. No, it should be not do. It should be while. I think I did mistake here. While. The mistake happens, so don't worry on that part much. I want to read this file. Yes, done. So let me explain us that script a bit. Maybe you didn't understand the beginning what it is. Now, let's see. So here what I'm doing, echo, I'm just printing this text to asking user to give the input. Then read, using the read command, I'm just taking the input from the user. You can take any kind of input. Cat, then I'm printing the file data in pipes and I'm concatenating it and passing it to next function or next execution statement, which is while statement here, while read line. While read line, line just reading from that particular output and do echo line. Just I'm printing the echo, like for each line what I'm doing. For each line do, you can run any kind of command to be honest, but I'm just echoing the line, and after the everything like this loop done, it's just exiting from that. That's what it's doing.
Okay. I think, yes,
you shown the, I mean, I've shown the, again, the very basic example. Again, similar way, you can run any kind of things you want. Let's move to the functions. I mean, in normal, let me share, stay in the slide first, and then again, we'll jump to the function in real command line, like I'm doing at the moment, okay? Let's see that, Chrome, share scripting. Okay, I hope you guys can see it now. Let's see. Okay, it's loaded now. Functions. Now, what are the functions? Function is like you create a like in simple word, you want to make your code more reusable. And you put inside a coding function block, and you can call the function to make the things happen. That's how simple it is. See here. So I'm like, you can define a function, say my func, then echo, then whatever you have to do. You can pass the variables here, and then you can run. But think that way. In a function, you can write all your statement. You can have 10 function, 20 function, and you can call one function from other function, right? You can organize the code that way. So there are pretty good use cases. I mean, ultimately, again, I'm saying it's up to your imagination how you want to use a sales tree on your function. But to understand how it works, let me show you a very basic example. Let's start from here. You see here my func echo is just doing hello one, and now hello dollar one means here whatever parameter supplied, like from the next we can say that variable command line like parameters, you can supply parameters using spaces. I will show there they are just taking the dollar one, that is the first, let me go, the first arguments. Now I remember. So it's arguments. First argument dollar one, second argument like that. You can like zero reference to the own script. It's a running script. Then the one to the whatever supply as a parameter there that way. So let me start showing that. Yeah, there is a good thing. So you can see the arguments part. Dollar hash number of arguments, dollar start all position argument as a single word, then dollar at the rate all position argument as separate strings, dollar one first argument, that's why I didn't check the this section first, but okay, dollar one is the first argument, and dollar underscore last argument of the previous command, note at the rate of, and dollar must be quoted in order to perform as described, otherwise it is really the same thing, argument as separate string. See the parameters. Okay, so let's write a function, simple function, hello world or hello whatever you want, and then see how it works, and I think that's a good start, isn't it? So let's do that. Let's stop this one. Okay, let's see. Stop the screen and share the command line. I think someone saying that how that capital, that proper case echo worked in script instead of echo. I think I rectified that, Anuj. So don't worry. That is typo error, you can say. Okay. I hope you guys can see the command line. Yep, you guys can see it. Let's create our world, whatever we have right now. Okay. So I want to show the function. So let's call it example 5. Okay. So nano, again, I'm using nano. I'm telling you, you can use any kind of, you can use your own like VS Code or any editor, or doesn't matter, any editor. The nano, then the file name is example5.sh. And what you want to do here, we want to write a function. Say, again, let's refer to the slide itself because we will be using the slide for reference, right? So my func, then just, these are the function syntax. I mean, I didn't define it, okay? So follow that. Most of the function, I think all other programming language is quite similar. Maybe the base is not there, but this is similar only. So echo the first parameter like that. If we do that, maybe it's okay. Control C. It's looking plain. Hello, Mr. Like this. What if we do that? And let's pause again. I mean, you know, first you have to do is like, I mean, since you're getting started, make it executable. Make it executable. Most people forget that and they didn't able to run it. Okay. You can see here. So chmod. That's why I took a lot of time to explain the chmod. Don't forget, you have to give it executable permission. I forget my tests myself sometimes. So, okay, don't worry. Make it executable. Example 5.sh. Now, let's execute it. Example. If we just simply execute it, nothing, right? But what if... Oh, I did one mistake. I mean, we called it. But where we are calling it? Yeah. So we have to call this function. I mean, simple about all other functions. You call this, you are just written a function, but the function will not execute until you call it. That's why it didn't print anything. Wow. So you have to call the function. Say, if we just try to run the function, what is it? My is going on the screen. Okay, my func, the function. What if we just try to run this and see what happens? Try to see that I put the right thing. Let's try to execute it. Hello, Mr. So it printed the hello, Mr. But it didn't print anything else. Why? Because we didn't supply any kind of parameters. Any kind of parameters we didn't supply. What if we supply a parameter? So what is a parameter I'm saying? It's a command line parameters. Or we can say we supply whatever here. So give space and then the parameter. The first parameter will be say, hello, Mr. Anuj, your name. So, it didn't print it. Let's see what happened. Why is it not printing? Oh, it's not printing. Oh, that's a good example also. See, I'm supplying it, but the printing is not happening. You know why? Example. I think this is very, see, the problem happening and solving, that's a good way to learn. I'm calling that, but in the function itself, I'm not supplying it. I mean, yes, of course, it is there. So what if we supply here $1? And let's see what happens. I will be explaining in a bit, but let's see what happens first. So did work. So why did it work? I mean, we are using $1 anyway. I mean, if we just clear these things. Can see the function again, that example 5.sh. We didn't mention this here, but of course we are mentioning it. Why did it work? Because in function execution, in function context, this variable refers to this function context. If you don't supply the value, that it is a parameter value that I'm supplying. So if I run here again, example 5, I'm running here. If you run it, it's not printing. Once, otherwise, I mean, you need some kind of reference, right? You can put any value here. You can put, you can just ask for a read also. Doesn't matter. There, you have to supply it. Suppose I didn't give anything right here. Here, I didn't give anything. Isn't it? That's why it's not printing anything. If I'm doing here, I'm seeing first parameter. Say Sandeep again. Say Sandeep, I'm just giving. Hello, Mr. Sandeep. What if we do Sandeep and say Anuj? It's printing still Sandeep because it's the second parameter. So what if we want to integrate this Anuj, that is second parameter also? So let's say. Okay. I'm a Sandeep and $2. That is second parameter. Again, this parameter is context to the actual function. If you don't pass to the function's parameter, it will not print anything. It will just end, and that's it. Let me show you how, and you will understand. say Sandeep. See, Sandeep and Ant, it didn't pass. If even if we give that Anuj, it will not work because we didn't supply to the functions as parameter. I mean, it's not a function parameter. We pass as a this file's execution parameter. I mean, this sales script execution parameter, not as a function parameter. If you want to give to function parameter, then here itself also you have to pass it, right? You understand the part that you have to supply here, no matter, even if you're supplying in a function, I mean, in the sales script, you have to take pass as the input to this function as a parameter. Then only it will work. Otherwise, it will, you just think, okay, oh, I'm passing it, I mean, a parameter, why is not picking the value? Because you're passing it, okay. But you're not passing as a functions parameter. So let me, I will give a more explanation in it, because in derivative type, these kind of things matter. In beginning, you don't know why I'm even using it, but it needed a lot while you work in the deployment. This kind of stuff, it works a lot. Okay, so Anuj, now see, it's printed. Hello world, sorry, hello Mr. Sandeep and Anuj. Now, if I say I'm giving Anuj again, let's go back. If I don't print here, okay, and $2 is okay. But I will not supply $2 here. Okay. Instead, let's say echo. We will call it direct execution. Okay. I'm calling it because I'm directly running the command. That's why. And here I'm just echoing the same thing. You will see the difference here. So it's I think okay. Let's run it and let's see why I'm telling this. Say Anuj. Anuj is a good name. See, here the function, this is the functions printing, the function execution. We didn't get Anuj. We got in the global execution, that is the normal script itself. Because we pass the parameter to the particular script, it have it. So that's how it works. You have to pass the functions parameter to make it use. Otherwise, you're not supplying it to function. You're just supplying only that. That's why it's your printing one. That's how functions work. I think, okay. Even you can store a function's value in a variable. Let me show that part. I think this is good. If you guys need the functions for reference, I may just put this code examples in Git repo if you need it. So let me know in the comments. Based on that, I will do. Okay. These are the running commands that you already see is working. So you will not complain to me, sir, this is not working. Because everyone coming back said this doesn't work. Okay. Now, example, I think how many examples did I? Okay, I know a lot of example I'm doing, but everything is required. That's why I'm going through all this. So just follow one by one. And after that, a complete example will just open your eyes. Okay, whoa, this, how this has happened, how this you take input, how you are doing the output and all. But for that, you need to understand the basics. Without basics, you cannot make advanced steps. First learn to walk, then to run. That's the basic analogy. Okay. Now, I will create a function, then we will return a value. Okay. Let's do that. So let's call it example 6. So nano, what happening? Nano, then example 6.sh. Yeah, what I'm gonna do? I will write a function, say my func again, or get value. Any function name you want to give it. I don't care. So any value. Then curly braces, like normally, you can think of a JavaScript function. Don't think like that, I'm just telling, but think kind of that, okay? And I want to define as the local variable. Say local, and then say I'm calling it expected result. I'm just saying expected result, you can tell it anything, okay? Expected result. And equals to, let's call it some input value. I'm just showing some simple value, and then I will show how to read from function. That will be also a great thing, right? And then echo that result. Okay, this one, just echo that. I think after that, I show you this part is interesting. I mean, I want to get this one as an output. If it's normal echo, then what happens? It's just show, nothing happening else, right? I want to store this value and then do something with that. Right now, I'll just store it and then show it. You can do any kind of stuff, to be honest. You can create a folder, you can create a directory, you can do any kind of command execution, to be honest. It's up to imagination. Just here, I'm just for example, I'll be storing the value and this print it. Let me show that. So call it result is equals to the function. I think, yeah, that's it. But if we do that and do echo, there will be error, but let's see what error happens. Then you'll understand why I'm telling it. Then echo result is then let's say the variable. Okay. Let's run it and see. Works, not working. We'll see. Now let's make it executable. The example.sh. Now let's try to execute it. See, result is get function. It didn't work. Right. So to make it work, what to do? You remember I told that if you don't, I mean, there is an evaluation, or you can to make it expect get some result from the function or any command, you have to use this command. This syntax using dollar then the brackets, and then inside that, if you give any function or any kind of command, that command's output or anything, I mean, output will be able to get in a stored in a variable. And then you can utilize that variable value to anywhere, up to you. So let's do that. And if you try to execute now, I think I did a mistake. Let's see. My function. Okay. I have to give this. That is something problem. Get function. Okay, let's try to first see that what happening. Why it's not showing that. See the error I did wrong. So if you think what error here, I mean, what did I do wrong? I am echoing this. But I missed the, I mean, it's, if we don't say it's a variable, it will print as normal string, right? That's why. So if I give dollar, then I'm referencing, okay, this is a variable. So echo the response, I mean, the output of a variable. So this is a variable, and then I'm echoing that variable's data, a variable's value, then it will work. So let's see. That's why the problem was there. It's good to know about the debugging also. There's only some input, right? So this kind of problem also happened. You have to find out and debug it like I did. And now what if we take an input from user and then see how it works? So now in function, can we take the like local, you're defining it some nothing. It's okay. Now read this variable and then let's do it. I should have printed something. Say sample. Little sample. You may just ask for something like that here. Let's say echo enter your input. And we do save it and then run it. Did mistake. Why the echo didn't happen? nano echo enter your input, and then okay, I did some mistake somewhere. Oh, I didn't close this one. But this is not that important, so don't worry on that part. Oh, if we do echo here, they're not happening. That result is getting here, right? So we cannot use echo here. Now that's a good thing. In function, you should not enter the input. Maybe before entering the function, collect the variables. So let's say I want to first, I can just pass the variable, right? Enter your input. It's a good example, like taking values input and then process in a function. Get function and then say read user input and pass it as a variable, as a parameter. So input and then pass it here. And then I'm not going to do the same mistake again. Okay. Then let's see. Might be some error is there, but that is fine. When you do fast coding, sometimes problem happens. So don't do fast coding in these cases. But anyway, think carefully before running it. So you get function. In the function itself, let's not take the input anymore because I'm taking it outside. Here equals to $1. So I'm supplying the parameter and you're taking input here. And let's see if that works. Just it worked. That's why I didn't prepare this script beforehand, right? I just in front of you written a script and it's working that way. See? Okay, now let's see what next it is. I've shown using the function, I've shown the this also. You can use a function as a the Boolean value as a condition, but maybe I will show when I show the conditions. Like now I'm going to show you the conditionals, which is very important as well. And then I will go. Okay. Okay. Harsha has a question. My company has given a DevOps role. I am fresher. Do I have a future? Of course, DevOps has a future. So I'll be coming to Harsha that in a greater depth. We'll be coming. Just first, let me cover. I think conditional, I have other arrays also to cover. After that is covering done, then we'll come to give all the questions. So anyone can have any question they can ask. So I'll be covering that later. Okay, let's stop that screen and share it. Start sharing. Okay, so we covered functions. Now we are coming to the conditions. So see, conditions we need. Suppose user input a value or we may have some kind of data. Based on the condition we process it, it is possible, right? And there are many ways you can handle the conditions. So in specifically to Linux shell scripting, these are the ways. So if you suppose and to check that particular variable is empty or not, you can use this, brackets and then third brackets and then give that minus, that dash z, and then the variable here. It's going there. Variable here. Again, to check that a variable is non-empty or not, you can give dash n like that. You are checking that string is equal or not. This is for equal checking. This is for not equal checking. And there is also a way to check equal or not equal part here. And if you can check greater or not like this, num, then dash gt, then the number, you can check that. I will be giving all examples. Don't worry, I'm just giving overview. What are the options you have? What are the syntax you have? And then we'll be covering how to handle it. Okay. Then equal, okay. And that regexp, okay. Option is enabled. So the short end is also there, okay? Okay, file condition, if the file exists or not, file is readable or not, symlink is there or not, directory, is it directory or not, is it writable or not, size is greater than zero or not, okay? Bytes in file executable or not. So these are the checks you can see here, all these five conditions. There's an example I'll be showing you just now. Okay, so here's one example I'll show. I'll be taking one input and we'll check that input have the values properly or not. Okay, maybe a particular equal value or not. Those kind of check I'll be doing. So let's do that. Let me stop the screen share and start sharing the console again. Okay. So you might see the screen now. Let's clear the screen. Okay. Let's have example 6. We'll call it this one example 7. So let's call it example 7. So nano example 7.sh. And then here I'm going to do, I'm taking enter your name. Sorry, I forgot the echo. See, that also happened with me sometimes. So enter your name. Then we will take an input in name. If name, let me see the variable difference. Okay, name not equal Sandeep. I'm just giving examples, don't take it seriously, but this is just for example. Okay, Sandeep, what happened? Then just a moment. Okay, then echo you are not Sandeep. That's a simple example. Okay, and then fine. Okay, I think now it's done. This is properly working or not. Chmod. In all the examples I have already mentioned in that document also that I prepared for you guys, so you can just utilize that later, don't worry. Chmod, make it executable, the example.sh file, and let's run it. Clear it and then run it. Anything. Okay, I think I missed here one thing. There will be a space. Then run it again. Okay, thanks. Okay, I think I missed the space there also. The space, mind of your space part, okay? Otherwise, you might get this kind of error. So make sure that the space, I think I was doing that. So in conditions, make sure if after if keep space, inside the conditional checking what you're doing, there also give some space. And I think, yeah, that's it. Then after the you maintain this part, you are giving it like the main condition statement. After that, give that symbol and use a then statement. Then inside before like if and before if I, that is a closing of the if function, you can run any kind of commands or any kind. I mean, you will do what you want to do. Okay, I'm just printing here that you want a Sandeep, and say if it's a Sandeep, then I need an else statement, right? If it's a not Sandeep, I'm giving this. If it's else, then echo welcome Sandeep. Welcome, I can use the name, right? And let's try to run it. Sorry. Okay, I think let me check. Okay, they use the normal one. Sandeep. or did it wrong? Nano Sandeep. Okay, if name not equals Sandeep, then this else that. Okay, so let's copy the value to make sure I'm doing properly. The name. Okay, let's see. What is that? Maybe that is the reason here. Now that's strange. If the name, oh, see, I forget to reference to a variable. This kind of mistake we make, but see, this is how it is. I think now it should work. I forgot to reference it. Proper variable referencing. Yep, worked. So make sure to give, okay, that's a good learning part. So while doing like in normal also cases, something, the normal cases in normal programming, you don't have to do that, but in shell scripting, make sure where you are comparing or you're checking with other variables or maybe some string values, make sure to give dollar than them. I mean, every time you're using that anyway, here I used it, right? So make sure to do that part. Okay, let's see. I think I want to show something. I think I missed maybe. So if I do that also, it will do the print. Okay, see, but the thing about the case where say Sandeep, what if welcome? I think this one may work. Okay, underscore I think will not work. So let me show that example. So now, okay. Yeah, see this variable didn't work because there, I mean, into this part is variable, but whenever I'm giving attachment to other, I mean, just since variable I'm doing this is not working, right? That's why it's good practice to use like this. You can pass any kind of variable, making a directory. If you like give the dollar name, then the next path, it will not work. You have to make sure for the variable part, use a curly braces, and that will make sure it will work. So if you see here, it's working. Okay, let's make it proper because I think I'll be having that in the Git for you guys reference. Okay, so you understand now the condition. I showed one condition, maybe just give you some more because otherwise it will be too few example I'm showing. Nano example 8.sh, sorry, example 8.sh. In this example, let's say I'm checking that a string, I will pass an environment variable and see that environment, let's say environment variables or maybe parameters, this is a parameter, parameter supply. If the parameter is empty, we'll say, please enter the parameter. It's a very common use case, right? So let's first put the parameter value inside a variable and we'll then check with the condition. So let's do that. So let's say user input, or could be anything. Say sample variable, doesn't matter. Any kind of variable I'm getting as a parameter. Okay, I'm putting the parameter inside the variable and then I'm checking if the parameter is empty. Say the parameter is empty. So check that parameter is empty or not is dash set. Then the variable. Okay. Then statement. Then we will echo. Please pass some value in the parameter. If it's success, or maybe say if it like else condition I want to add. So else if it's a good thing. Let me show how to do that else part also, else if part also. If the variable not equals, or maybe equals, say, what I have to say, any, we can say like, don't give some actual value, that kind of thing. Give him some, we can echo, please pass some meaningful. Now this is just a example, but you can put any kind of condition, to be honest. Meaningful value. And let's find. So what I'm doing here, I'm expecting a parameter, I mean, the pass the params while executing the script, and I'm storing inside a variable. Then I'm checking if the variable is empty or not. If empty, I'm passing that, please put the value. If it's NA, that's example, it could be anything. Then you'll say, please pass the meaningful value. And let's say the else also. Let's say thank you. Else echo thank you. Thanks, Jan. Thank you. I think that's pretty good example. So clear the screen. Yes, myself. I think we have a lot of files now. So example 8. Again, this is not executable. Make it executable. Okay, and then the file name, then execute the file. Syntax error else, let's see what happened. Okay, else if I think should be together. Let's see, now it work. Let's see, else, okay, elif. My bad, you know, using JavaScript all the time, this happens. So in cell scripting, it's L if, not the this thing. I think it'll work now. It's line number 7. Let's see. So syntax error near unexpected token else. Oh. See what mistake I did. I passed the elif properly. I think it's elif only. Yes, elif. But I did forget to pass the then statement. Okay. In normal editor, normally whatever it gives a linting error and you immediately fix it. Here it's a problem, I know. Okay, I did wrongly rename the value. So move that file name to just like previous file. Clear it and let's execute it. This file. Oh, okay, we have to make it executable. Mode plus X and this, then let's try to execute. Pass some value in the parameter. Like we are not passing. See the again. See the code here. In the code, we are saying, if you don't pass some value, please pass some value in the parameter. Say I'm giving nah. No such file or directory. Why is it taking this? I'm not checking on. I mean, let's execute the script using that and say, now, please pass some meaningful values. So it's coming to if else block, asking to pass some good values. So let's say, hi. Thank you. That works. So here, I mean, if you see it here, in if else statement, let me just clear the screen and again explain it, because if else statement you'll be using a lot, and that's why it's good to understand in a greater depth. So I'm being lazy and I know than the example 8.sh. okay, so So here, let's ignore the variable. I mean, you can take it variable as, I mean, instead of just I'm asking, taking from parameter, you can just say pass there also for the testing part. But since I show the example using the, from the parameters, so then let's keep it like that. So first I'm checking a string is empty or not, or like not set any values. Then I'm passing alarm. Then I'm printing this, or you can run any kind of command. Okay. And then like else part, right? If some command doesn't support, doesn't meet the requirement, else, like if, else if, like in normal programming, here it's different. Here, instead of else if separately, they're just simply doing ELIF, else if, and then the same condition, and then again, then statement, then the values, ultimately values mean the commands you want to run, you are going to run here. I'm just doing echo, but you can run any kind of command, to be honest. And then the final part, if no condition supports, the finally, what you want to do, you want to print something error, or maybe do some processing, and do it. Okay, so that's it. Now conditions done. I want to show some array and direct arrays. And after showing array, I will show the final, that how to move the some file using shell scripting to the S3. That part is important. Think about, like, you have say DB file. You every day you export the file and put the file in S3. That logic is a very common one, so I'll be showing that part. Okay. Okay. Now, arrays. Let me give you them. So let me share the screen where I will explain about the arrays. So share screen. Tab. Okay. This is arrays. So how can you define arrays in normal programming? Every programming language have their own way to define the arrays. In shell scripting, how will do it? This way. Okay. In shell scripting, give the brackets and then put the values like using space. And then you can, you can access each value like this. Okay. And working with arrays, it's just showing you how to work with arrays. So if you do echo fruit 0, then the first element will show. And if you give -1, then the last element show. If you give and at the rate of sign inside that that bracket, then it will go give all the elements with separated. If you do at the rate of and like hash, and then it will show the number of the elements you have, like length, array length function you see in the normal programming languages. Here it will be like number of elements, like the ultimate length in number. Like this is how, instead of dot length, think about like interpreted from existing programming language. There's the easiest way to learn anything, any programming language or any other things. So simply like map from there, how you're utilizing here, echo dot slash fruits, it is string length of the first element. If you do then hash, then the array variable name, and the third element, string length of the that particular, I mean three here. But you can put any number, and that element number will show here. Element string, that string length will show here. And I think, yeah, if you give echo, then the exclamation, then the variable, and at the rate of keys of all the elements, space separate will be there. Okay, I think some demo time. So let me show you how to work with arrays. I think, yeah, in you normal days, you'll be your day-to-day life, there may be or may not be situation we'll be using arrays, but if the situation arises, it's good to know how to utilize the arrays. So learn it. So example 9.sh. Let's create the file. Okay, so here let's define the array first. Let's say my items. In my items, I'm saying I have long syntax. I have item 1, item 2, not comma, sorry, comma is not allowed. Item 2, item 3, and item 4, and that's enough. item 4. So we have our array here. Okay. Now let's do some kind of fun stuff. Let's first print the first element. Let's see how it is. How we can do that. So echo, then dollar, then the my items. So first the variable name, and then the index. So what kind of, what number of, what is the index I'm trying to access? I'm trying to access the first item. So I will give as 0. You remember, sorry, not just 0, not 0. Okay, 0. Now, zeros, I mean, any in array start with 0. Okay, I mean, if you're a programmer, you already know. If you're not a programmer, we need you to understand that part. Okay, I mean, length will be starting from 0, but 0 is a number anyway. So we'll get the final length like that only. But it starts from the 0. That's it. So even if it's item 1, the index, or the it's starting from 0. So if I do try to print it, let's see what happens. Let's not make it executable. Chmod plus x, do it, and then run it. Item 1. It worked as expected, right? Because item 1. Similarly, say you can say item 1, first item. First item is item 1. You can do like second item. You can give like similar way. My item, then 1. Again, remember, it's starting from 0. So it's second item. That means calculate in mind. It's just the previous index. So it's 1. And let's try to execute it. The second item. Oh, I didn't, I forgot to put the value. Oh no, I think what happened? My items. Okay, I missed the S. You might notice that even I'm giving wrong variable, it doesn't throw error. Yes, it don't throw error, but you can enable the strict mode. I think then the error will show. Let's try to run it. Yeah, item 2. Okay. Now, what if we try to, I mean, we learn about looping, isn't it? What was the sample I forgot? What if try to loop it? I think that would be a good example, right? So let's try to loop and see if we can loop it or not. Nano. We want to, instead of like this, oh, if you just say, if you want to do it as example, I'm just commenting down. Okay. Okay, now I'll be running a loop. So for I in my items, then like if for I in items, I'm iterating in my items and I'm just echoing the value. So echo dollar I, and then done. That's it. Try to see any error or success. My items Y. Oh, I know what happened. See, again, I did the same mistake. You have to give us a in that you have to make reference a variable, right? So every dollar sign. Okay, let's try to run it. Item 1. Okay, it should print more. So let's see. Nano. So I in this. See how could you run it? See, like way I can run it anyway. That's not a problem. So my items. Okay. But I in that, you're doing echo. And what was the output? Let's see. Item 1. So he's just printed the first one only. I think I can do one more thing. To go line. Okay, run it. Okay. My items. Blue Eco, done. Let's try to do that in the C way. For I equals to 0, I less than. Now, how to know the array length? Again, see, this is how it's required. If you don't remember, the syntax will be a problem. To know the length of the items, you have to use dollar then the variable name my items, then the at the rate of sign thing that. So dollar then the variable name and then the the at the rate of. Okay, now let's try to run it. Add the rest of the things. I plus plus. Okay. Do echo dollar one. Sorry, dollar not one. I. And then done. Just try to run it. Less than expression, arithmetic expression required. So, okay. Go to the nano. Thing I did right. Let's see. Arithmetic expression required. I maybe missed something here. Let's see. Oh, I did one missing part. I have to give this. This is good learning thing. Unexpected that. Syntax error, line number 9. So it's saying. Keep it like that. Oh, it should work. Oh, that's a bad thing. Unexpected. It should work, but not working. Okay, let me find out what is the problem here. So don't worry. Cell script. Any problem happened, Google is there. Cell script array loop. So this. Let's see with a sample example first, and then we'll see why this array is not working. So let's remove this part first. It's a good problem statement. If you have not done it before, that's also good. Let's remove this one. So let's say remove this one. So if you just simple run to 10, it's running. So now n less than that, just a moment. Here, dollar then the my items. Then at the rate of, maybe try to print that how many that that is printing happening properly or not. Then we'll go. Let's see. So yeah, printing happened properly. Maybe I did some, you know, mistake in typing or something. It's okay. Okay, now instead of printing n, let's try to print the value. So my items echo dollar then the item, that is n. Let's see, might be error happen. Okay, item 1, item 2, item 3. I think let me just nano do echo. Make it inside a string just for the output part. I think this will work. It worked. Item and then the items numbers. It should start at 0. Yes, now it worked. Okay, so that's how the loops, you can loop between the arrays. And there are multiple other examples I want to show. So let's say the keys of all the elements. I think keys will be, let me show. Not that nano. I just want to show the keys of that particular array. So it will be echo all, say echo all keys. After this done, I'll be just jumping to the AWS example. So let's do that one first. Then the exclamation mark, then the item name, that array item, and then at the rate of. Let's see. It should work fine. Now again, all these examples, yeah. See, he shows all the keys, like index 0, starting from 0. That is good to understand. I will give the document anyway, so don't worry. I think we are done with 9. And the last example, I mean, I show you the looping, this and that. So let me show that some practical use case. I mean, you learn all this, it's okay. But I think you should understand the practical use case. Like, we learn sales scripting, but then do what? You can see already a lot of stuff you can do. A very practical use case, like moving a file from your local system to S3. So let's do that. So let me, I think I have a lot of a lot of buckets in S3. So let's say, for this, you need to have that AWS CLI installed. If you don't know, let me show you from where you can install it. I think I forgot to share the screen and I keep focusing on that. Okay, my bad. Okay. My bad. So let me again, I think I forgot to share the screen properly. That's why. So let me share the screen of the file that we last edit. So in this array example, it didn't work because here I was going wrong value. So for the loop to work, you just have to same syntax, only supply from here, like the initiate the variable and then put the variable like from which, how many loops you run and then increment it. And then from, you can pass the value here in that array parameters and do echo, you'll see the value of the particular item. So if you run it, say, you'll see it here. Item 1, 2, 3, 4. I don't know how I missed the sharing of screen. It's some hang up happened. Okay, anyway, so let me, I think, let me show you some, I'm moving to S3 from local instance, that part, the local machine, that part. For that, you need AWS CLI. Let me share from where you can install the AWS CLI. So, see screen, Google. So go to Google and search for AWS CLI. You'll find it here. If you're working with AWS, that is a very good example. Okay. And we'll find it for, you can download it for Windows, Mac OS, and all. Getting started. Use the latest version 2, because one is, you might get problematic. So sometimes you might some, you know, compatibility issues somewhere. So always start with the AWS CLI version 2. That will be very handy. Now I have already installed. If you don't have it, install it. And let me show you how I'm doing it. So screen, tab, application window. Okay. So let's call it example 10. So nano example 10 dot sh. And let's do it. So in this example, what we'll do is that we'll just have some, like ask in the console itself, enter the file you want to move, and the SA as a user enter, it will move to the S3. That's what we'll do. For that, and we'll ask for the user input file name and the bucket name. That's what we'll do. So let's say echo, please enter the file you want to move to S3. Okay. Read it, file name. Then ask echo which bucket to move. So ask, please enter the bucket name where you want to move the file. Okay. Now read the bucket name. Bucket name. And then AWS S3 move. Then, like, this is the practical use case. Why even we learn all this stuff? Variables, concatenation, all that. We learn for this moment. Like this kind of moment. So you can utilize all that syntax. So again, the file name should be, it could be full path. So let's say it's a full path, thing like that way. The file name. Okay, let's do it properly. File name, and then the where you want to move. So S3, then the bucket name. So again, here you also see, here also you need to use the concatenation. The bucket name slash. Okay. And then see it works or not. Okay. Then we'll see, debug it if it's not, doesn't work, and we'll fix it. So let's do that. So we have, this is, we are calling example 10. Make it executable. Sage mode plus X. Then the file name. Okay. So we have it here. Let's just verify the file is proper. So yeah, this is what it's doing. So if we execute it, let's execute it into the file name. We have a file called file sample txt. So let's copy that only. Now this part, I don't know. I mean, let's see how many buckets I have. I will just put in any example bucket. So S3, typing S3 LS. Sorry, AWS S3 LS. It will give me my list of buckets, my personal account. So let's say where I want to put it. say my, I will put it in sandeepdas.in. I'll just put it here. So let's run it. Say I want to move this file, a file example.txt, to where I want to move it inside this bucket. We'll see if this error happened, we'll fix it. I think it will work. Let's see. And yes, it moved. It moved to this this bucket. Let me verify it. Go to S. Oh, let me show you. Let's stop the sharing here, and I will share my AWS screen. So let's see. Let's come. I think we put in sandeepdas.in, my site link. Okay. And yes, this moved. File example. So see how I did it. How you might want to move bigger files, and you can move that way. That's easy. It is. You might want to move. See, I moved a simple file here. This sample text, but you might want to move bigger files. You can do similar way. I think in my past example also I have shown in many videos how to configure S3. You can follow that. Otherwise, just simply follow the official documentation link I just shown. You can do that way also. So yes, yeah, scripting. I think now I can take the question. I think I'm just done with showing example. So let me talk with you guys now. Okay, so I have seen a lot of questions. And let me do one thing. Okay, so I have all these questions and I'll be answering. So be patient with me. First question was, can we create a Twitter account with different email addresses and same payment method? I think it's possible. You can just try it and see. Please focus on registration and run services using script. That part I will be showing in the separate videos, not in this. This one is more like the syntax and all. That's I want to focus on. I did it. Focus on that part. If there are multiple types of shells, do anyway FX scripting? See, there are multiple scripting for different reasons, but I think for general use cases or our day-to-day use cases, bash scripting is everyone using. You should use the same thing. And unless you have a reason to use something else. Many guys think commands may not work in Windows from, of course, because Windows is a PowerShell, and that's why I never mentioned Windows in the beginning itself. So it's not that. So use PowerShell to follow. Yeah. So just even use that PowerShell. Some command maybe I think might not work, but you have to check. I mean, I'm not that much of a Windows user. Okay. So check that and then let me know. If it's Linux, Mac, or any Unix OS, it will work fine. That's guaranteed. Okay, Muhammad, I'm saying please the cable. I'm keeping the recording, although I did one simple mistake in the array parts. I did explain and explain without sharing the shell screen. I was focused on the experiment, that's why. But other than that, everything is like super perfect. You can just follow up that. Be careful using the RM minus RF. See, the problem of that is if you're seeing the RF minus RF, that means you're removing without any confirmation. It will tell you, not ask you what to remove, what to not. If you do that command, everything will just go, every remove. In that, you can suppose you have a lot of files, you don't want to keep any of the files, then only use that part. So keep them. But yes, that's Basuki saying that Sage mode can be executed on your root. So is this command working? Make sure. It's okay. If you have the permission, you can just use the sudo. I mean, if you don't have permission, you can use sudo. What is group like? The group of the, like in Unix system or any kind of system, there is, you can add a user to a particular group. So by default, you may, one user could be in part of admin group. That's why it's the user groups. So by default, you can also create using shell commands. You can create the groups. You can add one particular user group. Just like in, if you use the Amazon, there are group concept, like in a group have already some accesses. And if you add a user to the particular group, that user getting all the accesses, similar way in the Linux. It's just the same way. Okay. Okay. Which group you are referring in user groups? I think that's what I explained now. An awesome chmod calculator to convert Linux server machine into UN. Yes, I'll be sharing a document just after the session. Just after the session, maybe I'll just share now. I mean, why waiting this long? Is already session is done. I'm just taking Q&A, right? So let me give you the share and a viewable link. Restricted on people. Pop a link. Give me one moment. Viewer. So I'm giving the document link so anyone can download it, use it. It's a very good doc. I put a lot of work in this. So keep using it, okay? I'm just posting in comments. So say this is the slides or doc, what you want to say. And I'm posting it, so it will be like shared everywhere, in YouTube, LinkedIn, everywhere you should get the this file, and use it. It's okay. And if you want to share it with others, feel free to share it. I'm more than happy. Okay. Okay. Do chmod plus OX only for all you possible. I just forget what was that one. Short and sweet content, Sandeep. Thank you, Sairam. I think some problem has happened that time. How to disable the comment section? Just remove the hash and you can just uncomment that. I think enough while doing the file part, I already explained, Hemant. So you can follow that one. How echo works, so it didn't work. I had to rectify it. Question. My company has given DevOps role. I'm pretty sure two DevOps have future. DevOps have awesome future. Like people see people are more looking for DevOps engineers. The problem is that sometimes they don't want freshers, but I think if you're not a fresher, then how they will become experienced, how will they get job? I mean, if you don't give them job, how they will become experienced engineers? That's a very basic thing many people don't understand. I don't know. I think I know why, because they don't want to lose, but you have to have the will to experiment with the young generation. If you want your company to have growth, if you don't, it will never have growth. That's what I'm saying. So what automation tasks do this engineer? Can you please answer? So yeah, automation tasks say the automatic build system. I think CI/CD is a good automation part where you just push the code, and as soon as you push the code, then the build happens in the build system. What do you do? We have some Yarn build or maybe Nuxt build if it's a Next.js or any kind of build. We want to make a production build from the source code. Maybe it's a TypeScript. From the TypeScript, we want to make it a JavaScript, convert it to JavaScript, and then use that one. So there are a lot of cases, to be honest. So we do, and it takes a lot of time. Okay. And after the build happened, if you use the build system, the good thing is that you can use Cache. And the Cache is a lot faster. So we use, as a DevOps engineer, we have to like have the source, and then we make the build of that, and then we test the builds that is working fine or not, and then after that we push to staging. The QAs are there and everyone's there. They test the application. If they give approval to the particular, they get the approval link to it first, and once they approve the link, then the changes go to the production or maybe pre-production. They are someone with a higher authority check it. They also check, okay, it's looking okay and all good, then move to production once they approve it. Can you explain AWKRCD? I don't know. Or maybe later. Not today. I'm already tired, man. Please share the screen. Please share the screen. Everyone, please share the screen. Sorry, guys. I forgot to share the screen. But at the later, when I see your message in the comments, then I started sharing the screen. Sorry for that part. But other than that, everything is fine. So it's okay. Okay. I did a mistake there. So scripting is like a new program. It's kind of, yes, but the good part is that if you have good Linux knowledge, it's kind of a lot easier to you. I mean, if else, for loop, this kind of statement, if you think, it's very common for all the programming languages, right? So that also you find, like, once you map, suppose you're a programmer, once you can map your existing programming to this cell scripting, you master the cell scripting in no time. That's the beauty of it is. I think that's how it's designed. So that's a good part. Jagruti, that's an amazing session. Thanks for sharing your knowledge. Thank you, Jagruti. I mean, saying this this is a 2 hour and 30 minutes going to be session. And you stayed that long. It's a lot to me. okay. Ajay, thank you so much for the session. Thank you, Ajay. Shravan, thank you so much. Please cover the ACDA. Yeah, I will cover the ACDA next session. I mean, it's already too long session. I don't know who's going to watch it. I mean, I will keep the video in my YouTube channel anyway, because it's a good, I mean, we work all that hard for this session. So you stayed with me long that you watched the video and follow all the steps. So make sure that the slides I'm shared, I think already shared in YouTube should be available. And then start experimenting it. Who's just blogging? No one, right? Just go ahead and start experimenting. Shravan's saying, which one is better? Ansible and Terraform. Actually, I will say, if it's like you are managing a fleet of system, like system configuration management, okay? Think about the word I'm saying, configuration management, or maybe the management of the patching at scale, okay? In that cases, it's okay to go with the Ansible, okay? But if you want to manage the infrastructure, all this complex infrastructure, okay? I personally didn't find Ansible that appealing managing infra, okay? But in Terraform, in other way, you have a very pretty easy and good way. It's a very modern way, to be honest. I mean, there's a cloud formation to be, I don't like it. I mean, I know how to use it. I'm using it for like kind of, I had to, that's why I'm using it. I'm not finding it that user-friendly at the beginning. Now, since I'm getting used to it, it doesn't matter. Once you get used to anything, it doesn't matter. But when I first started using Terraform, it was that easy. Like within, I think, 1 day, 2 day, I was able to have my own infra running. It was like with all the security preferences, scalability, everything in mind. Even I had did some 1 or 2 session also in Terraform at that time. So Terraform is very easy. And for managing the entire infrastructure, maybe it's a complex infrastructure also, then also Terraform is a good choice. I think I did one project where I used the Terraform with Ansible provider. You can go for that option. It's a very good one. So you can use Ansible, Terraform together. Terraform for the, managing infra, and for the patching or the maybe some command execution or a lot of use cases are there. You can use Ansible. So you can use both together. It's a pretty, complex bit, but it will give you a lot more control in your hands. Okay. So make sure that part you use it. Okay. It's Leng saying that what is a best practice for multi-shell script for DevOps? So yeah, for if you are you have multiple shell script, you have one directory, make sure the file name you use should be exactly for the service or the reason you're using. So suppose for a build part, I'm saying for NX, like it's for building the NXJS. So NX_JS_build.sh. So that particular file for that only. We just execute for that step, and then maybe for other build, we use like separate file name. So that's how we can manage the multi. Don't put everything in a single file. That makes a life disaster. See, from one file, you can always run another file, right? Then why have the headache of doing everything in a single file? Just mention that's ultimately just a command, right? So in a shell script, you can just run another shell script. That is fine. So you can that way then do that. So keep other shell script, all separate service based or reason based file names, and execute that way. It will be great. I suggest saying it will be great if you cover the EKS session, setting up the ingress and deploying microservice on EKS, setting up the monitoring tool like Grafana using it. Actually, I had one EKS session in my library. I think that's the most viewed one, 15,000 views. You can utilize that one, but it's a bit outdated. I think I did 2 years back, to be honest. I will not suggest to go through that because there are a lot of new changes added, new services added, more improvement has done throughout 2 years. So I will say that use latest example, maybe AWS have it. I'm getting a lot of requests to make a ECS session. So what I'll do, there is already DevOps, ongoing session on the DevOps with AWS series, which already have 6 videos, I think. Next one going to come tomorrow. So it's pretty tough these days, but maybe in the next month, I know there's a high demand for that video, but maybe in the next month, this month, a lot of other stuff. Reskill guy, for them, I have to make videos. I'm not getting enough time because 2 projects have additionally taken and it's taking away all my time. So yeah, until like those two projects complete this week, then only I will be able to make more videos. Maybe the next month I will do it. Okay. Oh, next month I'll be in Hyderabad. So yeah, I will try to find out time. Let's see. I will try to cover the EKS. And EKS Fargate demo. While covering the EKS, I will cover the EKS Fargate demo as well. So Jagrid is saying that how is different from GCP from AWS? Is someone work with GCP, AWS difficult to learn? No, it's actually contrary. Meaning, instead of you are saying that if you have, you have background in AWS and you want to do some work in GCP, it's absolutely no problem to work on that platform because in maintaining make a model like how I certificate in GCP. While though I'm not using the GCP that much, because I map my model, in mental model I've created like this AWS service reference to in GCP this service, okay, and that's how I'm able to completely. I think I passed the exam within 30 minutes, and then I waited until the instructor wanted me to go. So, I did able to achieve that feat because I am able to map the AWS service with GCP and GCP services with the AWS. Similar way, you might have GCP, Azure, any cloud, to be honest. You see the similarity between the services, like say DigitalOcean, okay? DigitalOcean Spaces is actually a Dito copy of S3. So it's not that good. But the other Google Cloud, say Google Cloud Storage part, it's at the Google Storage, we have this S3, Amazon S3. Similarly, services are there. So map it, and that time you will not have no problem. So again, if you have GCP background, from there you want to go AWS, again, map the GCP service with AWS and you'll be able to achieve it a lot sooner. That's how it happens. Okay. I think we are all good. And I think I answered the last question also. So you guys, if you didn't subscribe, I think everyone subscribe only. I know everyone is already subscribed member, but if anyone watching the video not subscribed there yet, please do subscribe. It encouraged me to make a lot of more videos for you guys. This kind of very detailed videos I will always love to do. And again, sorry for the mishap in that edit section. Ignore that part. Otherwise, everything is okay. And if you guys want this kind of session, do let me know in the comments that okay, you want what kind of session like I did for sales script. If you like it, I will try to make other session as per the demand. Okay. Okay, thank you everyone. Good night and have a great weekend tomorrow. Okay, bye-bye. Thank you.